Dear students, I welcome you once again for the second semester BSc Physics class. In this session, we shall learn about real gases, Andrews isothermals, van der Waals equations. Now we shall learn about the real gases, the behavior of real gases, how the real gases can be liquefied, and the isothermals drawn for the liquefaction of real gases. And also we will learn about the corrections given by van der Waals and the equations so called as van der Waals equations. From the postulates of kinetic theory of gases, we assume that the ideal gas are dimensionless particles or dimensionless molecules. But in reality, atoms and molecules occupy a measurable volume. From the kinetic theory of gases, there is another assumption that there is no intermolecular interactions. That means the attraction or repulsion forces between the molecules, but it is not seen in case of the real gases. The gases which obey gas laws, that is the perfect gas equation PV is equal to RT, and have internal energy which is independent of their volume are called ideal or perfect gases. You have studied the Boyle's law, Charles' law, etc. The combination of these laws is the ideal gas equation or ideal gas law. The gases which do not obey gas laws, that is the perfect gas equation, are called real gases. The ideal gas equation is not valid for gas like oxygen, hydrogen, nitrogen, carbon dioxide, etc., and valid only in restricted conditions. Real gases, those are the gases found in nature, can deviate from ideal behavior, especially at high pressure and low temperatures. How they will be deviated from the ideal behavior, that can be seen later. The real gases can be liquefied or solidified under certain conditions of temperature and pressure, which is a large deviation from the ideal gas equation. The different behavior of the real gases from that of the ideal gases was experimentally studied by various scientists. Michael Faraday was the first to conduct experiments successfully on liquefaction of chlorine and a few other gases using technique of high pressure and intense cooling. The further investigations by scientists like Amagat, Holborn, Regnault and others, and also prominently Andrews, led to the discovery of the critical temperature of gases. You will come to know what is critical temperature of the gases in the forthcoming slides. They showed that there exists a certain temperature for every vapor or a gas above which the gas does not liquefy, however large the pressure applied to it. The validity of perfect gas equation PV is equal to RT derived from kinetic theory was put to experimental results by many with real gases such as hydrogen, nitrogen, carbon dioxide, etc. Andrews' experiments on carbon dioxide is particularly remarkable In that, it led to the very useful van der Waals equation of state. Now, we shall discuss about Andrews isothermal. Andrew in 1869 investigated the behavior of carbon dioxide and analyzed the pressure versus volume at different temperatures to determine exact conditions of liquefaction of the gases. Experiments on liquefying carbon dioxide was performed under suitable conditions and specially designed apparatus. Maintaining the temperature of carbon dioxide at a particular value, the volume of the gas is measured at different pressures. This is repeated for different constant temperatures of the gas. The graphs between pressures and volumes of carbon dioxide at each constant temperature are drawn. So these curves, which are drawn for the variables pressure versus temperature, can be seen in the figure. So these curves are drawn for different temperatures, that is shown in the figure, 13.1 degrees Celsius, 21.5 degrees Celsius, 31.1, 32.5, etc. So these are the different fixed temperatures. At these temperatures, the variation of volume versus pressure was drawn, and the curves therefore got or called the isotherms or isothermals for carbon dioxide. So these curves thus obtained are called isothermals, corresponding to different temperatures as shown in the figure. So the isotherms are the curves between pressure and volume of a gas at constant temperature. These isotherms will infer many behavior of the real gas in the process of liquefaction of the gas. At different temperatures, these curves are drawn. So each curve is a characteristic curve from which we can get information about the variation of volume and pressure at different temperatures. Now we shall look into the isotherm which is corresponding to the temperature 31.1 degree Celsius. So this curve starts from the point A. As shown in the figure, this curve starts from the point A. As the pressure is increased, the volume decreases till the point B. So this volume decreases and the pressure is increasing till the point B. Boyle's law is valid in the region AB. In this region AB, the Boyle's law is valid. Next, the volume decreases rapidly from the point B with pressure almost remaining constant. So here you can look a constant, a plateau, that is which is a curve parallel to the volume axis is seen. Here no increase in the pressure in this region. This region BC represents the progressive liquefaction of the gas. In the region BC, the vapor and the liquid are in equilibrium. That means we can see liquid phase as well as the vapor phase. Completely all the gas is not converted into liquid. Gradually the gas converts into liquid. Both the gaseous phase and the liquid phase is seen in this region BC. The gas gets liquefied, and any increase in pressure thereafter practically does not decrease the volume, since the liquids are incompressible. So from this point C, beyond this point C, if we decrease the volume further, there will be no decrease of the volume seen, because all the gases beyond this point C, beyond this volume, the gas is converted into liquid, and more volume decrease is not seen because the liquids cannot be compressible at large. But we can see that the pressure is suddenly increased at this point, beyond point C. So this portion CD represents the liquid state of the carbon dioxide. At 21.5 degrees Celsius, the curve is similar. You can look into the graph. At this temperature, 21.5 degrees Celsius, so we get a similar curve as earlier we got for 31.1 degrees Celsius. So only the thing is, at 21.1 degrees Celsius, the horizontal portion BC has decreased further to FG. When compared to the portion BC and FG, so this portion is a little decreased. But the isothermal at 31.1 degrees Celsius is entirely different. So at this temperature, so we can observe a different curve. The horizontal portion is just vanished. There is no horizontal portion. This is called the critical isothermal for carbon dioxide. Above this temperature, that is 35.5 degrees Celsius and 48.1 degrees Celsius, the horizontal portion does not appear at all, and the gas obeys Boyle's law from one end to the other. These isothermals are similar to the isothermals of air. At this point P, so where we do not get the horizontal portion, beyond this point the gas suddenly converts into liquid. There is no liquid vapor region. At this point the gas completely converts into liquid. Hence this point is known as the critical point. The temperature corresponding to this point where the gas completely converts into liquid is known as the critical temperature, and the corresponding pressure is known as the critical pressure, corresponding volume is known as the critical volume for any gas. So here it is shown for the carbon dioxide. Thus, above this temperature, that is 35.5 degrees Celsius and 48.1 degrees Celsius, the horizontal portion does not appear at all, and the gas obeys Boyle's law from one end to other. I explained this earlier. Above the critical isothermal, the carbon dioxide gas cannot be liquefied howsoever large the applied pressure may be. Below the critical isothermal, carbon dioxide gas can be liquefied by the application of pressure alone. The highest point P is called the critical point, and the temperature 31.1 degrees Celsius of the isothermal is called the critical temperature. From this, conclusions are drawn that it is not possible to liquefy a gas above the critical temperature. Next, we shall discuss about the van der Waals equations. Van der Waals equations are those equations which are just a corrections in the ideal gas equations made by the van der Waals. It was necessary for an equation for the behavior of a real gas, but the ideal gas equation was not suitable for the real gases. The ideal gas law treats the molecule of a gas as point particle with perfectly elastic collisions. But the gas molecules are not point masses, and the behavior of a gas often non-ideal, means that the observed relationship between its pressure, volume and temperature are not accurately described by the gas laws. Hence, in 1879, van der Waals modified the perfect gas equation PV is equal to RT by applying corrections for the intermolecular force of attraction and the finite size of the molecules. Van der Waals modified the pressure and volume terms, in the perfect gas equation PV is equal to RT. And he corrects the ideal gas law for real gas behavior. Now, let us understand the correction for pressure as well as the correction for volume. So here is a container or a vessel which is filled with the gas molecules. These gas molecules can move inside this container, and during the motion these molecules will have collisions, and these molecules will move with a kinetic energy. So whenever these molecules hit the walls of the container, so there will be a pressure exerted on the walls of the container. Now let us consider a particle which is named as A. So this particle named as A, this is a molecule of the gas which is well inside the vessel as shown in this figure. It is attracted by other molecules in all directions with the same force, and the net force acting on the molecule is zero. So here it is shown that this arrow shows there is a force of attraction by the other molecules in all the sides. Therefore, the net force acting on this molecule is zero. But when this molecule or any molecule strikes the wall of the vessel, so like this, so this particle A dash is shown, which is striking the wall. This molecule, when strikes the wall, will be pulled back by the other molecules, its velocity, and hence the momentum of the gas molecule will be reduced. The momentum with which it will strike the wall would be less than the momentum with which it will strike in the absence of the force of attraction. This reduction in the momentum results in decrease of pressure. In other words, the absorbed pressure of the gas is less than the actual pressure. The absorbed pressure of the gas is less than the actual pressure of the gas. Hence, there was a need for the correction for the pressure term. The correction for pressure P depends upon number of molecules striking a unit area per unit time of the walls of the vessel, and the resultant inward pull of cohesion on each of striking molecules. Each of these factors is proportional to the density of the gas. The correction for pressure P is proportional to square of the rho. That means it is the square of the density, which is inversely proportional to square of the velocity. Rho square is proportional to 1 by V square. Therefore, P is equal to A by V square. So here A is a constant which describes the strength of the attraction, and V is the volume of the gas. Therefore, the corrected real pressure can be given as P plus P, that is equal to P plus A by V square. So this term A by V square is a correction term which gives the magnitude of force of attraction by other molecules. Hence, we can also write the ideal pressure is equal to real pressure plus the correction term A by V square. In other words, also we can say the actual pressure is equal to observed pressure plus the pressure of attraction. So now let us look into the correction for volume given by van der Waals. Due to the finite size of the gas molecule, the actual space available for the movement of the molecule is less than the volume of the vessel. That means the actual volume available for movement is the total volume minus the volume that was occupied by the molecules. Hence, a correction for the volume was required. The molecule have a sphere of influence around them, which is of radius 2r as shown in the figure, so within which no other molecule can penetrate. So here the dotted line shown in the figure is the sphere of influence. So this sphere of influence is drawn taking the radius as 2r and the center as the center of the molecule A. So here the dotted line gives the sphere of influence. So in this area, no other molecule can penetrate in this region. So this region is known as the sphere of influence. So here r is the radius of the molecule and 2r is the radius of the sphere of influence. So now the volume of the molecule can be given by x is equal to 4 by 3 pi r cube. So this is the volume of the molecule. The center of any two molecules can approach each other only by a minimum distance of 2r. Hence, the volume of sphere of influence of each molecule can be denoted by S, and it is given by 4 by 3 pi into 2r cube, that is equal to 8 into 4 by 3 pi r cube, that is equal to 8x. So here x is the volume of the molecule and S is the volume of the sphere of influence. Hence, the volume of the sphere of influence is 8 times the volume of the molecule, that is given by S is equal to 8x. So now let us fill the volume available in the vessel. Let us fill the volume with the molecules one by one. Let V be the volume of the molecule, and for the first molecule, if we fill inside the vessel, the entire volume V is available for the first molecule. Then if you fill the second molecule, the volume available for the second molecule will be lesser by some factor. So this reduced volume is the volume of the sphere of influence. Since the molecule cannot penetrate into the sphere of influence, for the second molecule, the volume available is V minus S, V minus 8x. like this, we can add n number of molecules in the available volume V, and by simplifying the equation we arrive at the equation for the volume available for the nth molecule, which is given by V is equal to V minus n minus 1 into S. Hence, the average space available for each molecule can be given by V minus ns divided by 2, and this can be written as V minus 4 into nx, or it is V minus b. So this term V minus b is the correction term in the ideal gas equation PV is equal to RT. So where this b is equal to 4 into nx is the 4 times the actual volume of the molecules, where the b is a constant which describes the size of the gas particle. Thus the van der Waals equation of state of a gas is given by p plus a by v square into v minus b is equal to RT. So here the van der Waals made the corrections for the term P and the term V, that is the pressure term and the volume term, and this equation is known as the van der Waals equation, where A and B are called the van der Waals constants.